actually an organizer a couple of years back in today's lecture. So she said, I think the student was the most fun. So we'd like to join the kids. So I'll be talking about frustrated magnetism. So today's talk will be about frustrated magnetism in general, but the talk tomorrow will be focused mainly on quantum spin liquids. So we'll have quite a few talks about quantum spin liquids over the next week, next couple of weeks. So both Patrick Lee and Matthew Fisher will talk about that. I'll try to give a different perspective over here. So before I get into the main topic, maybe I should acknowledge a few people. So mainly my student, Fa Wang. I've done a lot of this, the things I'll be telling you about with him, but also all these other people who have collaborated with over the years. So why are we so interested in quantum spin liquids? So for the longest time, it was mainly a theoretical interest, right? It was this very beautiful state of matter. And for those of you who don't know too much about quantum spin liquids, I'll of course be talking more in detail. But essentially, a quantum spin liquid is really a very quantum state of matter. So most spin systems or most magnets, if you cool them down to low temperatures, they just tend to order. You just get magnetic order. Which can be very interesting, but ultimately this magnetic order is a rather classical state of matter. Okay, so although the ingredients that you put in, spin 1/2, often very quantum spin, you take a large collection of these, make them interact, ultimately the low energy physics of your system is described by this order parameter, something that tells you about the nature of this magnetic order, and that you can think of as arising because many spins condense into the same state. Okay, so once you have many particles, many quantum particles occupying the same state, that object becomes a classical object. Okay, so ultimately all these ordered states of matter are, the physics that emerges is rather classical physics. Okay, and the quantum spin liquids gives us another option, a way in which matter of, interacting matter with many constituents can stay quantum down to the lowest energy scales. Okay, so it's an extremely interesting phase of matter. But until now, the experimental footing for this phase has been somewhat dubious. Right? People have suggested various materials could be quantum spin liquids. It was first seriously invoked in the context of the Coupe rates, but there's never really been any smoking gun experiment. Okay, over the last few years, there have been some candidate materials where no magnetic order has been seen down to very low temperatures, and the general tendency then is to assume that it's a quantum spin liquid. Okay, but that's more of a negative sign. You don't see something that you expect, therefore you conclude that it's a quantum spin liquid. Okay, so just to motivate my lectures and all the other lectures that are going to focus on this on quantum spin liquids, let me tell you about a very new development. So this is literally came out a month back and was published a month back. So this is an experiment on a quantum magnet. So spin 1/2 living on the triangle lattice. So the compound is this very complicated looking formula. In fact, that's actually the short form for what that compound's name actually is. So this is some organic material, but for our purposes, it's a spin 1/2 system living on this triangle lattice. Yeah, and it's an electrical insulator. If you go and measure the electrical conductivity at low temperatures, that conductivity is just zero. Yeah, but the amazing thing that they find is that if they go and measure, instead of electrical conductivity, they measure thermal conductivity, how this material conducts heat. What they find is that, that's this pink line over here, as you go to very low temperatures, you find a large thermal conductivity. In fact, if you look at what exactly is being plotted over here, this is the ratio of thermal conductivity divided by temperature. Okay, so the only materials we know that give you a finite number for this value at low temperatures is a metal. Okay, so in the past, the only materials that people have measured such a thermal conductivity is a metallic phase. Okay, but this is an electrical insulator. Right? So it's, as far as charge conduction goes, it behaves like an insulator. As far as heat conduction goes, it behaves like a magnet. Okay, so so we're sort of used to this idea that things that are good electrical conductors are also good thermal conductors. Okay, that's something that is sort of phenomenologically true. But if at room temperature, there are many exceptions to that. Right? You can find insulators like diamond that are very good thermal conductors, but are electrical insulators. Okay, but if you go down to very low temperatures, where you really have to think about the quantum state of a system, it was more or less assumed that anything that's a good thermal conductor, so in the precise sense that this ratio thermal conductivity divided by temperature goes to a finite number, it was assumed that such materials are also electrical conductors. In fact, for metals, there's a relation that tells you that this quantity, cap over T, is the electrical conductivity times some universal constants. Okay, let's not worry about what those universal constants are. Maybe some factors over here. But essentially, for metals, this is a law that's called the Wiedemann-Franz law. And at low temperatures, this is always believed to hold. And in any metallic phase, you know, this relation holds. This is sort of the definition of the metal. Now, it is also assumed that if you have a finite value for this quantity over here, it means that you have a metallic phase. Because if you think of any other way of conducting heat, for example, you can conduct heat through phonons, through lattice vibrations, all of those contributions to the conductivity, thermal conductivity, go to zero in the limit of low temperatures. Okay, essentially because there are very few excitations at low temperatures. The only phase that has enough excitations at low temperatures to give you a finite thermal conductivity is a metal. Right? With the Fermi surface, you've got a large number of excitations that can be made near the Fermi surface of the metal, and that can end up giving you this metallic or this large thermal conductivity. Okay, so what this material seems to behave like is that it has a Fermi surface, but it has, but the, it's the Fermi surface of some excitations that don't carry charge. And they carry only spin, not charge. That seems to be the, at least from the point of view of phenomenology, that seems to be what's suggested. And there's some very beautiful numerical and theoretical work that suggests indeed this is a reasonable theoretical description of this phase as well. Okay, so so this is sort of a preview to the kind of theories we'll be discussing in the next lecture. But the important point I want to make, which is which one can only make in the last, in the very recent past, is that indeed all of this physics of quantum spin liquids may actually be seeing some experimental confirmation. Okay, so let me get back to the beginning of this talk, which is to try and define the terms I had in the first slide. So what do we mean by magnetism? What do we mean by frustration? So this might be familiar to many of you, but just to make sure everyone is on the same page, let me go over this quickly. And of course, feel free to ask questions anytime. Okay, so we'll be talking about magnetic insulators. Okay, so the fact that they're insulators will help us a lot. It'll simplify the problem enormously. So essentially all of these magnetic insulators arise from a phenomenon first described by Neville Mott. So they're called Mott insulators. So you have electrons that pop around on a lattice. So I'm imagining these blue circles are atoms, the red are electrons. So if you neglect the interaction between electrons, these just hop around and you decide what the excitations of the system are by solving the band structure of this material. Right? But what Mott said is that often you have to worry about the interaction between the electrons. So let's think about some interaction U a repulsion, Coulomb repulsion. It's maximum when these electrons are on the same side. Okay, so there's a competition between electrons wanting to hop around and gain kinetic energy, and the fact that they want to stay on different sides and not pay this Coulomb penalty. Okay. So if you're in the limit where this U is much larger than T, the electrons end up getting localized at sites, and if you have an integer number of electrons, for example over here, one electron per site, you'll end up with an insulator. Okay, and so there are many examples of these kind of Mott insulators. Typically they occur in transition metal oxides. So transition metals are metals like iron, cobalt, copper, manganese, etc. This particular row of the periodic table. And when you make oxides of these materials, it turns out that this ratio U over T tends to be large. Okay, there's large repulsion, small hopping, essentially because the orbitals from which these electrons live are rather small and there's not much overlap between the neighboring orbitals. Okay, so when you end up localizing the electrons like this, you can forget about the charge degree of freedom. Okay, there's one electron per side. The only question that remains is what is the spin doing? Okay, so this, each electron has a spin. How do these spins get ordered? How do those spins interact? Right, so really this is a very simple quantum many-body problem. If you like, it's sort of like the hydrogen model of quantum many-body physics. You have a spin at every side. For example, if it's spin 1/2, it can be in one of two states, and then you have many of these sides. Okay, but how do these spins typically interact? So if I have a pair of sides with opposite spin, you can have a virtual process where the electron hops onto the neighboring side and hops back, and then you can gain some kinetic energy. Okay, whereas if these spins were parallel, there'd be Pauli blocking, you wouldn't be able to do that virtual hop. Okay, so there's some slight advantage by, for these spins to be in a singlet state so that they can hop onto the same side and occupy the same side, as opposed to being in a triplet state. Okay, and you can summarize that by this Hamiltonian. There's the spin of the first side dot the spin of the second side. Okay, and the coefficient in front is positive. It's anti-ferromagnetically coupled by virtue of this gaining this kinetic energy. Yeah, and as you can see, this coupling over here comes from perturbation theory. It's typically much smaller than either the hopping or the repulsion. Yeah, and so if you have some lower energy scale J that emerges, and if your temperature is lower than this, smaller than this energy scale, typically these spins will order. Okay, now the exception is in frustrated systems, and that's really what we focus on. You can put temperature scales much lower than this energy scale J, and yet the system doesn't order. Okay, in fact, that would be a way of defining frustrated system. Okay, so let me give you one example, one physical example of such a magnetic insulator. This is really the most famous, probably the most famous Mott insulator around. It's the parent compound of the high-temperature superconductors. Okay, so you take this material, it's a magnetic insulator, you can dope it, and then you end up getting a superconductor, and the superconductors in this family have the highest known transition temperatures. Okay, so the fact that these states are born from this Mott insulator has made this a very interesting topic for many people. It appears that if you understand better this magnetic insulator, maybe you can understand better how we can get a high temperature superconductor, how we can understand the nature, the origin of this high temperature superconductor. Yes, although you're studying the physics of an insulator, it has implications that are much broader than just the magnetism of this insulator. Okay, so the typical values over here, so this this material actually has these copper ions, that's the relevant atom over here. They form a square lattice. And on each copper side, there's a spin 1/2. It's a quantum spin 1/2. And when you go through this exercise, you find that there's an exchange coupling, a coupling between the spins that's antiferromagnetic, and it's of order about 1,000 Kelvin. Okay, so those are the typical kind of energy scales we're talking about, whereas this T and U, the parameters of the original model, the hopping and the repulsion, are more like 10,000 Kelvin. Okay, so already this is a lowering of the energy scale. And if you go to temperatures of order hundreds of Kelvin, like 300, 400 Kelvin, this system orders. Okay, you get magnetic order. Okay, so that's as far as magnetism goes. What about frustration? So what do you mean? What do we mean by frustration? So the origin of this word is thinking about a situation where you have many competing interactions. Okay, and you can't simultaneously satisfy all of them. So the usual example that's given, think of a triangle of spins. So these spins can either be up or down. Okay, they'll be Ising spins, so either plus one or minus one. And let me take the same interaction as before, antiferromagnetic interaction between the spins. Okay, so these spins like to be antiparallel. You can get a pair of them to be antiparallel, this pair also to be antiparallel. But then you're forced to have those to be pointing in the same direction. Okay, so you can't really gain the energy of this bond. In fact, that bond ends up being unhappy. so this is a frustrated situation. Okay, in contrast, if you did that on a square lattice, you can make all of these bonds happy. That's unfrustrated. Okay, so this is rather This is sort of the origin of this term, but it's not a very useful criterion. A somewhat better criterion has to do with the following definition. So what you see is that this back bond over here can live anywhere. It can be on this one, it can be on this, or on this third site. So there are degenerate states over here that different states that all have the same energy. Okay, in fact, if you expand this out into a lattice, let's say I make a lattice out of these triangles, make a triangle lattice, or if I make a different way, if I put the triangles together in a different way, where these the triangles are corner sharing, you get something called the Kagame lattice. So in both of these cases, it turns out, starting from this observation, you find that there are many different ground states that all have exactly the same energy. Okay, so example, this is a ground state of this triangle lattice model with this with these spins, but also if I flip this spin, that's also an equivalent ground state. Okay, in fact, the number of ground states goes exponentially with the number of sites in your system. So it's exponential of that number times the number of sites in your system. There's an enormous number of ground states. Okay, but these ground states are not related by any symmetry. Okay, so so that will really be our definition of frustration. So we take a frustrated model and look in the classical limit, where I have classical spins and I can talk about configurations. You have many, many ground states, and they're not related by any symmetry. They're accidental degenerates. Okay, similarly, on the Kagame lattice, you have an exponentially large number of ground states. In fact, even more than the triangle lattice, and you'd say that this thing is even more frustrating. Okay, so so a bit of history. For a long time, I thought Kagame was the name of a person who invented this lattice. But it turns out, apparently, Kagame is the name of this kind of basket weave. It's a Japanese word for this kind of basket weave. And you know, once you know about this lattice, you'll see it in many places. I've seen it on, you know, as decoration on walls of medieval buildings and things like that. Okay, so so today I'll mainly be talking about systems where we have Ising spins. So at least there'll be a limit where we can think about the spins as being Ising-like, either up or down. Okay, and that would be a big simplification. And since this is a school, I want to really work with the simplest model to begin with. Once you figure that out, you can work with more complicated models. Okay, but I should mention that you can also consider a spin model, which is actually more typical, where the spins are three vectors, right? Really vector spins, Heisenberg spins. So this is a three vector, a unit vector dot its neighbor. So this classical spin model, you can ask, when is this model frustrated? Okay, we'll use our definition of frustration, which is whether we have a large number of accidental ground states or not. Okay, now surprisingly, it turns out the triangle lattice, when I really look at vector spins, and just when I have just the interaction, which is nearest neighbor interaction, that's no longer frustrated. Okay, the sense is actually a unique ground state up to symmetries. Okay, whereas if I look at the Kagame lattice, this turns out to remain a frustrated lattice. Okay, even with vector spins, there are many different ways in which you can, many different classical ground states that you can find. They all, of course, have the same energy. Okay, and the way to see that is if I have this Hamiltonian on the Kagame lattice, I can write it as the sum of the three spins on a triangle, the whole square. Just up to some constant factor, I can write it like that. And I can simply add over all the different triangles. Okay, so then these are really independent blocks. I have a block for this triangle, a block for that, and so on. And to minimize the energy, I just need that the sum of these three spins adds to zero. Okay, if I can arrange that, I've got a ground state of this model. Okay, and of course, there are many different ways in which you can arrange this. For example, even if I just restrict the spins that live in a plane, it turns out there are many different ways of doing it. Okay, you have a choice whether these spins spiral around clockwise or anti-clockwise, and you have that choice at every triangle over here. Okay, so there's a large number of ground states. Okay, similarly, on the there's a three-dimensional version of this Kagame lattice. So the Kagame lattice is corner-sharing triangles. You can make a three-dimensional lattice where you take a tetrahedra, so four spins that are all equally coupled to one another, and make them share corners in three dimensions.
Sorry.
Yeah, so those are Ising spins. But let me, for a moment, think about Heisenberg spins, which is a unit vector. Okay. So I've So this is sort of an aside to tell you that what we'll talk about today is not the end of the story. Okay, so one way of putting these tetrahedra together in three dimensions is called the pyrochrome lattice. Okay, it looks like that. And again, you can do the same trick. You can write the spin Hamiltonian over here, just this nearest neighbor spin Hamiltonian, as the sum of these the four spins on the tetrahedron whole square. Okay, and those are independent blocks, and again, you just try to minimize these blocks. That gives you many different ground states. Okay, so so if you sort of set it up like this as a mathematical problem, it sounds interesting, but you wonder whether nature actually realizes such frustrated systems. And why would you get systems which have large accidental degeneracies, large numbers of accidental degeneracies? Okay, so the surprise is that, in fact, frustrated systems are relatively common in nature. Okay, in fact, this pyrochrome lattice over here, there are many materials that take up this pyrochrome lattice, many magnetic insulators. Okay, but actually, let me give you an example of the simplest, or at least the best known material, which is actually frustrated. So it's a very familiar material to all of you. So actually, it turns out ice is an example of a frustrated system. It's just ice at ambient pressure. It's not a magnetic system, but the idea of frustration, of course, is more general than just to magnetic systems. You can think of many different systems which have accidental degeneracy of their ground states. Okay, so the first time this was, there was a hint of this was, I guess this was 1930 or something like that, 1936. So these two people, these two chemists, were making measurements of heat capacity of many materials. Okay, and the idea was to try and prove the third law of thermodynamics. Okay, so if you calculate, measure the heat capacity of a system from very high temperatures down to very low temperatures, what you can do is you can integrate that. C over T will give you the change in entropy. And you can figure out what the temperature, what the entropy is at some low temperature if you know what it is at some high temperature. Right, and actually, we know what it is at high temperatures. You can use the ideal gas law to estimate what the entropy is. Okay, so you do this for most substances. You go down to low temperatures. These two quantities miraculously cancel and give you zero. Right? That's the third law of thermodynamics. It tells you the entropy vanishes as you go to zero temperature. Okay, so one exception was ice. Okay, so they do this for ice. What they found is that at low temperatures, like 15 Kelvin or so, which is below most of the relevant energy scales for ice, you find that there's a residual entropy. Okay, so there's some non-vanishing number. that they found. So this was very puzzling to them. So they went and talked to Linus Pauling. Yeah, and actually, he figured out the right answer, and the answer is actually mentioned in their paper as well. Okay, so Pauling actually knew about the structure of ice. Okay, and so the ice, if you think about what the oxygen atoms are doing in ice, they form this sort of crystal structure. Let me look at just one unit of this crystal structure. It looks like a tetrahedron, right? So the midpoints over here of these bonds form a tetrahedron. So there are these four atoms of oxygen. And of course, you have two hydrogens for every oxygen, and they live along these lines, along these bonds. So now, to make it look like a molecule of water, you need two of these hydrogens to be close to the oxygen, and two of them to be far away. So those are called the Bernoulli-Fowler rules. The structure has to have this rule that two are close and two are far. Okay, so it turns out there are many ways in which you can do this. You can pick any two of these four sites to keep the hydrogen close by and the other two to be far away. Okay, so Pauling did an estimate of this, and actually I'll leave it as an exercise. It's a very hidden back of the envelope calculation, which you can do also. And he got this number, which is extremely close to the experimental value. And so essentially it's this degeneracy, the fact that you have these many degenerate states, and the ice is somehow exploring all of these different degenerate states, that gives you this residual entropy. Okay. So so more recently there have been spin versions of ice, so they're called spin ice. They have a similar lattice structure, but instead of these hydrogen positions, you really have spins. You have spins that can either point in or point out of this tetrahedron. And again, there's a rule that two of them should point in and two should point out. And you get exactly the same kind of degeneracies, but because this is a magnetic system, you can do a lot of different things with it, and I'll talk a little bit about this in the next lecture as well. This is a very interesting example of a frustrated system, and many examples that have been found in materials. Yeah, question?
So, presumably, if you go in a low temperature, there's some low energy reactions that
that's right, yeah. Yeah, so there are two options. One is you actually resolve this degeneracy and you find some unique ground state. Another thing that could happen is that you fall out of thermal equilibrium. Like you get, the system is, as you cool it, the system gets stuck in some particular minimum and it's not able to get out of that in the experimentally relevant time scales. So it turns out for ice, at least the there haven't been any very modern experiments, but the old ones seem to show that it undergoes this sort of glassy physics at low temperatures. It's not able to equilibrate, and it may also have to do with the disorder in the system. So it's actually an open question for ice what exactly happens when you go to even lower temperatures. If it stays in thermal equilibrium, ultimately this entropy should be quenched. You should recover the third law of thermodynamics, which is there's a unique ground state, but that's assuming that you stay in thermal equilibrium. And so that's a good question because it sort of leads me to my the outline of my talk.
When you say glassy behavior, do you mean it colloquially or that's really like a glass? Like if I look at the density of states for lower energies, will it be the same? For example,
You mean like a structural glass?
Like
window glass?
Spin glass? I don't know.
Yeah, so that's a good question. I think it's more an experimentally. You know, it's a statement based on the experimental fact. So when you do an experiment, like when you cool a system, you assume certain cooling rate, right? So for that cooling rate, it turns out your system is not able to equilibrate for that particular cooling rate. Now, is it truly a glass in the sense, is it, you know, is the relaxation time, has the relaxation time really diverged, or is it something smaller that you could access by doing a more careful experiment? I think that has not been clarified.
Okay.
But that's a good question. In what ways is it like a regular glass, and in what ways is it different? And you see similar things in the spin ice as well. Maybe there's a better chance of answering these questions.
Do you know why it wasn't clarified? Because it's kind of easy to do. I mean, you just measure.
You mean specific heat or something like that? Or specific heat has been measured.
I mean, resistance, low energy resistance. You should be very sensitive to the density of states. Obviously, spin flip scattering will be sensitive to.
For which one are you thinking?
For both.
I mean, so you know, this spin ice is an insulator. It's a very good insulator, right?
Insulator, right? Nothing is really insulator. So.
No, at these low temperatures, you really can't measure a resistance. I think it'll be really, really high.
So it's zero for. Right?
Yeah. You can't measure it. I mean, ice is a different question. I think ice, you can actually measure the resistance. Protons can move around and you can get some resistance. And that's an interesting question too. So the conduction will be actually through defects. You'll have some defect of this arrangement that will be the conducting unit. So that's an interesting question. But yeah, it's not, experimentally it's not been settled in any detail. Okay, so this question that Leo raised was, how does a general frustrated system, at least my interpretation would be, how does a general frustrated system ultimately find a ground state? Okay, so there are different ways in which that could happen. One way is, and this will really be the outline for the rest of the talk, I'll try to give you examples of these different mechanisms. So one way is that you have some residual interactions that you didn't look at. It's sort of a trivial a way out. This is an accidental degeneracy, and it depends on having a very special set of interactions. Any real system, you'll have some weak interactions that will break that accidental degeneracy. Okay, so the whole fate of the system depends on what those weak interactions are doing. Okay, so if I think of some representation of my frustrated system like this, you have some minima. So these are two different configurations, x1 and x2, but they happen to have the same energy. They have some residual interactions, they can break this degeneracy. Okay, so I'll give you one example, which you can get very complex kinds of magnetic ordering from this, from the fact that you have these residual couplings. Okay, so another mechanism which is interesting is that you can get a selection of the ground state from fluctuations. Okay, so if you have a finite temperature imposed on your system, you have thermal fluctuations. Or if you have a quantum system, what we have is a classical representation of the states. If I add some quantum mechanics, then I have quantum fluctuations. And both of these can actually select a ground state. Okay, so this mechanism is called order by disorder. So it's somewhat paradoxical because usually you think of fluctuations as destroying order. Right? You take a magnet, you heat it up, you lose the magnetic order. You take some magnetic system, you imagine increasing the quantum fluctuations, you tend to lose that magnetic order. Okay, but here the system, as it is, the classical system, can't really make up its mind which ground state to pick. Okay, and then it's really the fluctuations that can cast the vote and help it decide which ground state to pick. Okay, so I'll give you an example of this. And again, because this is not restricted to magnetic systems, it'll turn out it's useful to think of this in terms of not spins, but bosons, and there'll be a nice kind of order that emerges from this. Okay, so so one simple picture for how you can get this order by disorder is that you have these two classical minima, but now imagine that these are, this is really a quantum property. Right? So something happened. Okay, so imagine this was a quantum particle, in which case you'd have some zero-point motion, right? You'd have some zero-point energy, and that will depend on the curvature at the bottom of these potential minima. And those could be different, and those can end up helping you select the state. Okay, so we'll see that this is kind of the mechanism by which some quantum fluctuations, for example, would end up picking this particular state over that. Okay, so in this way, you can end up getting very complex kinds of magnetic order. But all of these orders are, in a sense, conventional. They're all described by some order parameter. And we can we sort of know theoretically how to describe these states. Okay, so probably the most interesting outcome that could happen in these frustrated systems is that because of this frustration, you force the system to try to do something different. Okay, so normally these magnetic systems want to order, but because of this frustration, you can force them to do something different. And one of the things that they could do is to form a quantum spin liquid. Okay, so to, again, go back to this cartoon picture. The idea of a quantum spin liquid would be you have all of these different degenerate ground states, classically, and now put in quantum mechanics, and the quantum mechanics will help me, can allow me to tunnel from one ground state to another. Okay, and in this way, you can end up creating a quantum superposition of all of these different ground states. And the phase that you will end up with, this quantum spin liquid, is not described by a lambda order parameter. It's and you really need to search for alternate descriptions. Okay, and we'll come to what these alternate descriptions are. But one important thing to realize is that often the terminology, the way it sounds, is that this quantum spin liquid is one phase. And people will ask, is this a quantum spin, or is this the quantum spin liquid? Okay, so there's no dirt quantum spin liquid because there are many, many varieties of these quantum spin liquids. Okay, they form a class, and as a class, they're very distinct from conventional phases, but again, within that class, there's a lot of variety. Okay, and the way we use, the tools we use to describe these quantum spin liquids are things like topological order or the existence of gapless excitations, which are unrelated to symmetry. Okay, so, but this will, most of this will do in the next class. And one next lecture, and one sort of unifying theme that seems to that we seem to see in all of these quantum spin liquids is that gauge theories arise as the natural way to describe it. And we'll start with a little bit of that. So let me get back to the first topic in this outline, how some residual interactions can end up selecting the ground state of your system. Okay, so this is an example that I like, and the examples I'll give will be based on this triangular lattice that we talked about. If I have Ising spins on the triangular lattice, spins that can only point up or down, I have many ground states that we talked, and how does my system select between these different ground states? Okay, so one mechanism that you can imagine is at work is that in any real system, I will have these fins living on the sides of a lattice. And the lattice is not rigid, it can move. Okay, so depending on which spin configuration you have, the lattice could deform. Okay, so I've lost the spin away, it'll spin up over here. For example, if the central spin moves a little bit to the right, it can end up getting a stronger exchange with this neighbor and a weaker exchange with this one. And it can slightly lower its energy. So it can take advantage of the fact that this this lattice can move. Okay? So you can put that into some formal language. You have an exchange interaction between neighboring spins. And now, depending on the location of these spins, the exchange can be modified. Okay, so there's some derivative of this J. Depending on how much you move, that J changes. Okay, and then there's some restoring force. Of course, the lattice likes to be undistorted. Okay, so such similar models have been studied by other people for different lattices, but let's apply it to the triangular lattice. That's the simplest case. Okay, so it turns out that if you solve this problem, you can ask which configuration of these different ground states, these different icing ground states, takes the maximum advantage of this sort of lattice distortion. Okay, and it turns out it's the state, I've used blue for spin up and hollow red for spin down. Turns out this is the state that gains the most energy when you allow it to relax in this function. Okay, this zigzag state, this z state. Yeah, so you might think that this is a good state for if this mechanism is at work. Okay, and in fact, there's a particular material, it's copper and oxide, it's got essentially classical spins on a triangular lattice. And over some range of temperature and magnetic field, you get precisely this state. Okay, so, of course, at this point, it's a little dangerous to conclude this is the mechanism at work. You could have many different mechanisms giving you the same state. Okay, but what they did in that particular for that particular system is that they can apply a magnetic field, and they can see what are the different phases that they get. And it turns out that we can do the same in this particular model. You turn up the magnetic field, and you get a different state of these icing spins. And again, this the particular lattice interaction selects a unique state. And this state has got a finite magnetization. It's got 1/5 magnetization, so it's slightly more upturned spins than down spins. And it ends up forming some sort of regular pattern like this. And it turns out this state is also seen in this material. Okay, so both this and this other state are seen, which gives us some confidence that this is really the mechanism at work. Okay, similarly, you can predict another state at higher magnetic field. That plateau has been seen, that particular magnetization has been seen, but the structure is unknown. So you have a prediction which can be verified in future experiments.
There's no 120 degree state?
Sorry?
The 120 degree state that you talked about?
Yeah, so that's a good question. I kind of skipped over that in the interest of time. So it turns out that when you have this coupling to the lattice, so for example, over here we have a model which is really a Heisenberg model that has this coupling to the lattice. If the coupling to the lattice is strong enough, it destroys this 120 degree state and gives you a collinear state. So it prefers the spins being collinear, as you can imagine, right? You get a bigger energy gain if the spins are collinear as compared to them being the 120 degree state.
There's a threshold?
There's a threshold, yeah, that's right. So in fact, I'll show that on this phase diagram. And we believe this material has actually crossed that threshold. So in fact, that was one of the surprising things about that material. You would have expected a 120 degree state. It's pretty isotropic. The spin exchanges pretty Heisenberg-like. But it turns out that it's collinear state. So that's another point in favor of this mechanism. Okay, so you can draw a phase diagram. So just to give you an idea of how complex these spin structures can, how complex spin structures can emerge from these frustrated models, let me show you this numerically generated phase diagram. The two parameters are the coupling to the lattice. So at zero, there's no coupling to the lattice. You'd expect to get the 120 degree state, as Leo pointed out. And you can increase the coupling to the lattice. And then along this axis, you have a magnetic field. Yeah, this is a very simple model of these spins coupled to the lattice and the magnetic field. Okay, and so that's what this phase diagram looks like. So at zero field, there's some threshold before you go out of this 120 degree state into what we call the zigzag state, but there are many other phases. Okay, and all of these fractions over here, they represent the magnetization of these states, the certain fixed magnetizations at which you get certain crystalline states. And even in this very simple model, you see that there's a complex phase diagram. Okay, so actually, when we wrote this paper, a referee pointed out to us that there's some problem over here. There's a point over here where four phases meet. Okay, and so if you remember your, I guess, undergraduate chemistry, there's a rule called Gibbs phase rule. So you can have at most three phases meeting at a point when you draw a phase diagram like this, you know, with two axes. And there's simply four phases meeting over here, so is that a problem? Right. So it turns out it's not a problem, it's actually a nice feature of this frustrated system. So if you go back to how you prove this Gibbs phase rule, so if you want to have three phases meeting at a point, you need to make sure that their free energies are all the same. Right? So the three phases, there are two pairs of free energy differences, E1 minus E2 and E2 minus E3. You need to set both of them to zero. That you can do with two parameters. So that you can do on a phase diagram like this. Okay, but if you want to have three phases meeting at a point, you think generically you need more than two parameters to do that. Okay, but it turns out that you have an accidental degeneracy over here. Turns out two of these phases have exactly the same energy. And because of that accidental degeneracy, you can sort of violate the Gibbs phase rule. Okay, you can have a point where you have more than three phases meet. Okay, so the accidental degeneracy we saw before was just frustration. That's a different way of defining frustration, and it appears over here. Okay, so in a real system, of course, you don't exactly have the model we wrote down. You don't perfectly have this accidental degeneracy. So this would be a near meeting point. There'd be some slight separation of these two phases by some small line. But you can sort of detect these near violations of the Gibbs phase rule. Okay, so accidental degeneracy gives you consequences for the phase diagrams. Okay, so that was completely a classical problem. Now let me think about the same problem, these icing spins on the, yeah.
So in this spin funnel model, do you take into account only sort of a static distortion of the lattice or fluctuations of the lattice too?
Yeah, so this was, so it turns out you can integrate out the fluctuations.
Right, it will matter. Give you 4S interaction then, right?
That's right. In fact, the way we do this is through these 4S interactions. So the, you know, even when you solve this model which has no fluctuations, the effective spin model that you write down when you integrate out that phonon degree of freedom is this one. You've got an exchange interaction. And you have the second term over here, which is some F squared. But the F itself is a product of two of these things. So it is some very particular set of four-spin interactions that's giving you this water.
So, but then if it's spin 1/2, there is no such thing, right?
Yeah, so if you think of quantum spins, right, if it's really quantum spins, this will end up giving you some further, a longer range, two-spin interaction.
Uh-huh.
Because they, it turns out because they share a site, it gives you some longer range spin interaction. You could get a four-spin interaction in spin half if they're all four different sites.
Right.
But it turns out these are, they share a site. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we've not really looked much at the quantum model. This was really for classical spins. Okay, so so in fact, this there's a certain history to this problem. So you know, many years back, Anderson and Fizikas actually talked about such a triangle lattice model where the exchange interactions between the spins are highly anisotropic. Okay, so they imagine spin 1/2 on the triangle lattice. So these are quantum spins, and to a first approximation, the spins interact via this interaction. Okay, only the z components of the spins interact. By an antiferromagnetic interaction. Okay, so if this was the only term you had, that's the same as the classical Ising model on the triangular lattice. It's highly frustrated at many degenerate ground states. Okay, but they ask the question, what happens when I put in a little bit of the X and Y spin exchange? Okay, so those are also going to be antiferromagnetic, but with much smaller strength than this JZ. Okay, and what they argued was the ground state of the system is what they called a resonating valence bond liquid, what today we would call a spin liquid. Okay, and so that was the first example of someone trying to say that there's a system that has the spin liquid physics. Okay, so what we do now is to really analyze this model in detail and ask, does it have such a spin liquid ground state? If not, what is its ground state? Okay, and this is a quantum model because it's really spin 1/2, and this term over here generates some quantum dynamics. Okay, and we'll see what that quantum dynamics is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you say, why did they look at the anisotropic portion? It seems like anisotropic portion is less rough filling.
No, so the anisotropic version is the one which actually has the frustration, right? So suppose I went to the isotropic point, the Heisenberg point. On a triangle lattice, like you said, it has this 120 degree ground state. And so in the anisotropic limit, it seems like it's more frustrated. That's one reason. Another reason is, as I've described, there's some way in which you can try to analyze it using the ground states of the sensing model.
You sort of like it's going towards 1D limit as well?
No, it'll be 2D, but we'll use the grounds, the different ground states, and try to argue. You know, so their argument is sort of heuristic, right?
But the lattice is isotropic.
The lattice is isotropic, yeah. Is there some other question? Okay, so let me give you a different way to represent the ground states of the sensing model. Okay, so we said there are many degenerate ground states, and the rule for that was if you have a triangle of these spins, there's one spin that's unhappy. Okay, and the other two spins are happy. So you can represent that one bond as a bad bond. So I have to use these squiggly lines for that. Okay, and the rule is that there's one and only one such bad bond for every triangle. You're forced to have one bond, and you keep the minimum, which is just that. Okay, so a different way of representing these ground states is to draw the dual lattice, take the midpoints of this triangular lattice. You have triangle up and triangle down. Those give you two different kinds of sites. And if you end up joining these points, you end up with the honeycomb lattice. Okay, you end up with this green lattice. That's the dual lattice. So now every time I find a bad bond along the triangle lattice, this kind of bond with squiggly line, I'll draw like a dark bond on this honeycomb lattice. I'll call that a diamond. Okay, so you can represent all the ground states of this Isaac model on the triangle lattice in terms of some pictures on the honeycomb lattice. The picture on the honeycomb lattice turns out to be very convenient because the rule is very simple. Okay, the rule is that out of every site, you have one and only one dimer coming up. Okay, and people have a lot of experience with such models. They're called hardcore dimer models. So you can map the ground states over here to the configurations of hardcore dimers on the honeycomb lattice. Okay, now this is actually a 2-to-1 map because if you know where the bad bonds are, it still doesn't tell you what exactly the spin configuration is. You need to be given one spin to figure out the spin configuration. It's 2-to-1 math, but that 2-to-1 is not very important. It's more or less a unique map. Okay, so now what is, so that's what the first term does. It tells you that you like configurations that look like these dimers, okay, which have exactly one dimer coming out of every side. Okay, now what does the second term do, the term that involves the x and y spin components? So that gives you some quantum dynamics. Okay, it moves you within the space, and if that term is very small, if j is very small, I only need to consider matrix elements that live within the space of ground states. Okay, I don't really need to consider excited states, they're much higher off in energy, they're separated by an energy gap of order jc. Okay, so the dominant term coming from j is to take a particular configuration of dimers that looks like this and takes it over to this configuration, okay, where all the dimers are kind of rotated around along this object. Okay, so it looks like a resonance move. I mean, you have these benzene resonances. This is like a resonance of some double benzene molecule. In fact, that's where part of the name comes from, the resonating valence bonds. They thought about these as some bonds, like in benzene or something like that, and they're resonating around. And they thought of the ground state as being some wave function superposition of all the different ways in which you can resonate these bonds. Okay, so the different ground states of the Isaac model are all combined together with some coefficients to give you this resonating valence bond wave function. Okay, they propose this is the ground state of this model, and it has no order because no particular configuration of dimers is selected out. And when no particular configuration is selected out, naively it means that there's no spin configuration that's selected out. Okay, so we want to look at this problem. We actually have some other motivation to look at this problem, but it's also interesting from this historical point of view. So how would you try to solve this problem? Right? How do you attack such a problem? So the nicest thing is if you had a model which has no sign problem. So I'm sure you've heard about the sign problem in different lectures. Now, if you have this antiferromagnet on the triangular lattice, it definitely has a sign problem. Okay, so for this particular sign, it turns out the sign problem lives in this J. If this J is greater than zero, you have a sign problem. Okay, so you can't use quantum Monte Carlo. You can't really take very big system sizes and solve it to figure out what the ground state is. Okay, so for a moment, let me evade this issue by considering the opposite sign of J. So what if I have J less than zero? Right, so I still have this kind of resonance move. I have this kind of quantum dynamics. But I'll give it a weight, a matrix element that's negative. Okay, so it's not that, you know, in some sense, it's not that different from the original proposal. Just change the sign away. So now we can, you know, use quantum Monte Carlo and simulate it. There are other techniques we can also use. It's a much simpler problem. We can solve for the ground state. Okay, I'll describe that first. And then I'll argue that, in fact, you can map this problem to the J less than zero problem. You can map these two problems to one another if you live only in the space of these low energy states. Okay, so in fact, it answers the original problem that we had. And so that would be the plan. And finally, I'll give you some conceptual argument which will allow you to argue that this model over here couldn't have been spin-like. It had to be ordered. And of course, that was not known in 1973, but more recently, because we have understood the connection between spin systems and gauge theories, turns out we can take over results that are well known in gauge theories to argue that why this thing couldn't have been spin-like in the first place. Okay, but anyway, so this would be the plan. So let me first start with this. Let me just switch around the sign of J. Think of some general model where I have ferromagnetic exchange along the x and y direction, but antiferromagnetic exchange along the z direction. Because that's a rather unnatural model to think about in terms of strengths. Okay, why would one of the sign of the couplings be ferromagnetic and the other be antiferromagnetic? Okay, but it turns out it's a very natural sign of coupling to think about if instead of spins, you think of this as bosons. Okay, so I'll talk about that in a minute. So the spin model that we wrote down is actually equivalent to a model of bosons hopping around on this triangular lattice. Okay, so let me just sort of change representations for a minute. So there are two reasons to do this. One is it would be clear that sort of frustration physics is more general than for magnetism. Another reason is it would turn out that the ground state we get for this model is most interesting if you view it as a collection of bosons rather than as the set of spins. Okay, so what's the nature of this mapping? We said we had spin a half. In this SC basis, this up and down spins, you can think of as being either an occupied site or an unoccupied site of bosons. Okay, so these are really, you can think of this really as being a set of bosons. The only constraint is that you can never have more than one boson on the site. Okay, so it's sort of hardcore bosons. It's bosons that hate to live on the same site with some strong repulsion and on-site repulsion. Okay, so now what is the different terms in our Hamiltonian mean? So for example, you can look at this term, this SZ-SZ coupling. So when you write it in terms of the bosons, it tells you that neighboring sites want to have different occupation numbers. There's actually a repulsion between the bosons. And the other term, this X and Y couplings, turn out to be just hopping of the bosons on this lattice. Okay, so if I put those things together, the Hamiltonian that we'll be interested in is some hopping term that's going to be weak. We're really going to be interested in the weak hopping limit and some strong repulsion on the triangular lattice. Okay, so normally if you're given some model like this, what you believe, what one naturally expects, is that, let me think of this as a general model. You have some T and J. For very large hopping strengths T, the bosons hop around. There's a lot of kinetic energy that they can gain by condensing into a particular state. Okay, you expect it to most condense. You expect to get a superfluid at large T. Okay, now, as I start increasing the repulsion, this J, by the same mechanism we talked about in the first couple of slides, the bosons don't really want to hop around that much. Okay, they'd rather be in some fixed locations where they can avoid each other. Okay, and you might end up, you'd expect that in this limit, you quench that kinetic energy and you end up getting some crystal phase, some particular solid phase. Yeah.
What happens if you map the fermions?
Sorry?
Is it possible to map the fermions?
Okay, so this term over here, this hopping term, so if you just had this Isaac term, it doesn't care whether it's bosons or fermions. And in that case, it's, in fact, it may even be a little more natural to map it to fermions, because this hardcore condition is naturally satisfied. Okay, but when you think about this exchange term over here, this exchange term is not the regular hopping of fermions. Okay, so you can always map it to fermions, but you'll get some extremely complicated term over here, which represents the spin exchange. Okay, and the reason is that if you look at spin operators in different sites, they commute. But if I think about fermionic operators in different sites, creation and annihilation operators of fermions in different sites, they don't, I mean, they anti-commute. There's a way to fix that in one dimension, which is to use this Jordan-Wigner string, but it gets less and less useful as you go to higher dimensions. There is some formal way, but it's the Hamiltonian becomes non-local in higher dimensions.
What about filling for you, for the imposing? Do we need to...
Say it again.
What about filling?
Filling, okay.
Is it fixed by the original spin model somehow? Or?
Yeah, so for now, let me assume that this is at half filling. So in the original spin model, that corresponds to having zero magnetization.
Oh, right.
Right, so, but you know, in a sense, what you'd like to do is you'd like to say this model is actually at zero magnetic field, so it's at some particular chemical potential, and you let it decide what filling it wants. Often this will also be at zero magnetization, but not necessarily. You could get a ferromagnet.
For example. Is it possible to realize frustrated hopping in experiment?
It may be possible, yeah. So so the experimental realization of such a bosonic system, actually let me come to that in a minute. Let me come to your question in 1 minute, yeah. So let me go back to this phase diagram that we were trying to think about. In this large J limit, you might expect to get a solid. Okay, but this is a special system. It's highly frustrated in this limit, and it's not clear which solid you'll get. Okay, so we originally thought that you'll have these two phases. You'll have a solid phase, you'll have a superfluid phase, and we were actually interested in phase transition between these two. It turns out we were wrong, at least with this large JZ limit. Okay, it really has to do with the fact that this is frustrated. But the outcome turns out to be a little more interesting than what we originally thought. Okay, so what might be a physical realization of this bosonic model? Actually, there's not any very good physical realization. You could, of course, have bosons on a lattice like they do over here. Or at least that they do in after-cold atomic systems. You can have bosons hopping around on an optical lattice. The hard thing will be to get such a repulsion between neighboring sites. And possibly you could get that if you have dipolar interactions between atoms. But this is still for the future. It would be interesting if one can make such a Bose-Hubbard model, but with repulsion between neighboring sites as well. Okay, so the question was, can you get the opposite sign of hopping? And there may be some ways in which you could do that, to engineer the opposite sign of hopping. There have been some proposals. Maybe I won't go into that right now. Maybe you can talk later about how one could hope to engineer the opposite sign. But there are some proposals where these bosons emerge from pairs of fermions, and then you could end up getting the opposite sign of hopping in some regimes. Okay, so let's look at these two different limits. One limit, we are pretty confident what will happen if this hopping is large, we expect to get a uniform superfluid. But in the opposite limit, you might have expected a solid. So this was actually studied by many people, including Matthias Kreuer, because of the absence of a sign problem, you can look at large system sizes. And what was found was that, in fact, if you look at large values of this repulsion, you do get some kind of charge order. Yeah, so this is an order parameter for the charge order as a function of system size. So this is extrapolating to the thermodynamic limit. Let's just look around this this axis. So as I go to larger and larger JC, as I go up to JC equal to 8, I get a clear signature of this crystal order. Okay, and the crystal pattern looks like this. It looks like there's a large density site at the center and surrounded by low density sites forming this honeycomb lattice. Okay, so there's a clear evidence for this kind of crystal order. But the thing that was somewhat surprising to us was that if you look at the superfluid order parameter, or rather, most strictly speaking, the superfluid density, which is an indication of whether you have superfluid order or not. This order, of course, is very large if you have weak repulsion. That's this expectation over here. So Jz equal to 3 has no crystal order, but it has, but it's a superfluid. But as you crank up this repulsion strength, the superfluidity still remains. Even at the largest repulsion strengths over here, and the superfluid order doesn't die out. Yeah?
Is it a formal definition of M?
Okay, so M, so if you look at this pattern over here, there are 3 sublattices, right? There's this central site, let me call it A, and there are these 2 other sites, B and C. Okay, so this M over here is taking the density, Fourier transforming the density with this particular wave vector. So it is the density at the site 1, at the central site, plus the density over here times the phase factor, which is this the phase factor for this particular wave vector, plus the density at this third site. So it's the Fourier, it's a Fourier component of the density, which as you would normally do to find the order parameter of a crystal. So if I imagine doing, you know, X-ray scattering or something on this, this is really the magnitude of the Bragg spot, the intensity of the Bragg spot.
So this superfluid density being smaller than 1, in the usual superfluid density is the entire density, and
right.
condensate diffraction is just tiny, right? It's just depleted if the interaction is strong. So
yeah, if you have a translation invariant system.
That's translation invariant.
Yeah, a Galilean invariant system, yeah. Okay. Whereas over here you have a lattice, so you can have a very small superfluid density. Okay, so this phase is a combination of the solid order on the lattice and superfluid order. Okay, so it's the lattice analog of a supersolid. So this is a phase that people are very interested in seeing in typically in more continuum systems, things like helium, where you have no lattice imposed. Here we have a background lattice, but this phase breaks this, even the symmetries of the lattice. Okay, so it's a lattice version of a solid, and it has coexisting superfluid order. Okay, so as you increase this repulsion strength, it turns out you never get a solid. Even at the strongest repulsion strengths, as long as you have some finite hopping, you end up with some superfluid order. Okay, and that's really a consequence of having frustration. There are many different ground states that are present, so this repulsion is not really that effective at making the solid. Okay, so that was, you know, the opposite sign of this hopping, of this exchange. We had this thing which was more natural for bosons. Now let me get back to the problem we were initially interested in, which is to have the all of these couplings being antiferromagnetic. Okay, so this was the thing that had the sign problem. But it turns out that if you're in this limit where this Jz is much larger than T, we actually found that there's a unitary transformation. Okay, so this is somewhat analogous to the transformations you do in, the sort of Marshall sign transformations that you do to map a regular antiferromagnet to something that has no sign problem on a bipartite lattice. Of course, this is a more general situation, and it turns out only when you project into this subspace of states, these ground states, can you find such a unitary transformation. Okay, so let me tell you what that transformation is. So let me think about the ground states of this model in this dimer representation. Okay. So I have some configuration of dimers on this particular lattice. Each one of them gives me an equivalent classical ground state. Okay, so the unitary transformation is something that acts on these on this dimer configuration, and it's going to be diagonal in this dimer configuration. So all I need to tell you is what is the phase that I get, phase factor that I get, when I act on this particular dimer configuration. Okay, the way in which you do that is you take whatever dimer configuration you have and superpose it to this particular pattern. Okay, every time you get a superposition of a dimer with one of the brown bonds over here, you multiply your state by a factor of I. Okay, so this transformation, turns out you can easily check, is such that when you look at this dimer move, this dimer resonance, it changes the sign of that dimer resonance step. Okay, it maps you from a problem with positive T to a problem with negative T. Okay, so in this limit of very strong repulsion is a way to map these 2 problems. Okay, so that immediately gives us some information about the problem that we're interested in. Yes, so the first question is there any kind of magnetic order for this extremely anisotropic XHZ mode, okay, which was postulated by to be a spin liquid? And we can immediately answer that to be yes. Right, so we know that if I look at the spin-spin correlation function on the other side of the phase diagram, which didn't have the same problem, we saw that it was ordered, right? We saw that there's some pattern. And because this unitary transformation is diagonal with this particular basis, you get exactly the same correlation with the opposite sign flux. Okay, so we know that this is magnetically ordered. With a little more work, what you can do is you can actually figure out the exact pattern of magnetic order. Okay, so let me sort of skip over the details of that. So this is based on a nice variational wave function that was proposed by Arnab and his collaborators for the unfrustrated case, and we can map it, we can do the unitary transformation on this wave function. So I can discuss that in more detail if anyone is interested later. But ultimately what comes out of this whole exercise is a phase diagram for this XXZ antiphotonic. Okay, so the postulated phase diagram that's based on all of this evidence, what we have found, so this on the left over here is the antiferromagnetic site. This is really the site that we're interested in for a magnetic model. All the couplings are antiferromagnetic. Okay, so this special point over here turns out to be the Heisenberg point. Okay, this is where we expect it to be, this simple 120 degree ordered state, even for the spin a half system. What we have solved for is the point over here, which is highly anisotropic, where this JZ is much larger than this X and Y puppet. Okay, and what you find from this exercise is that the pattern is not that different from the 180 degree pattern. These are the direction of the spins on the three different sublattices. Okay, so there's one that's pointing entirely up, the other two are pointing down, but with some angle in the XY plane. Okay, so this is some deformed version of this 180 degree state. So the most natural phase diagram to propose is that you go from this 180 degree state uniform smoothly over to this other state over here without any phase transition. Okay, so so the input we had really was this point over here. When you're extremely anisotropic, we could understand what this pattern was because we solved for the pattern just on the other side. And we could relate the two sides by the symmetry transformation. Okay, so this is really the answer we believe for this XXC antiferromagnet. Unfortunately, it's not a spin liquid. It's a particular magnetically ordered state. Yeah, is there a question?
Yes, so in the case that you were an extremely big pattern, the corresponding phase for the bosons?
Ah, that's a good question, yeah. So so let's say you actually had a spin liquid for this particular case. What would be the phase for the bosons? Okay, so to some extent, it actually depends on the exact representation that you have. So in some simple cases, it turns out the spin liquid of such a dimer model turns out to be an insulating phase of the bosons. An insulating phase which has, it has no superfluid order, but it has no crystal order either. So imagine you have some bosons, let's say on a square lattice or something like that, and you're at a filling of one boson per two sides. So if I told you this system was an insulator, you would normally assume that there's some arrangement of bosons occupying sites and empty sites. Right? There's some pattern of this of these bosons that are formed, and they're formed in insulator. But it turns out the analog of a spin liquid for bosons is that you have an insulator, but the bosons are not, they're not forced to live on particular sites. So you'll have, for example, a completely uniform state of bosons, that the density of bosons is the same on every site. You have all the symmetries of the square lattice, but it's an insulator. Yeah. So for this particular model, I'm not sure, actually, because over here, the representation in terms of dimers is rather different. So for example, you can change the density of the system while living inside this dimer subspace. So it's a little more complicated over here, but roughly speaking, those are the kind of phases you expect.
Is that type of phase called a Gauss liquid?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So the question is, would you call such a phase a Bose liquid?
What is the definition of Bose liquid?
Yeah, so you'll have to try to make up the definition from the title. Yeah.
Is water those liquids?
So, you know, so when you think about phases of matter at zero temperature versus a phase of matter at finite temperature, right, like at room temperature, so there's a big difference. So at regular room temperature, there are, you know, you can think of all kinds of phases. You can think of a liquid, for example, right, and we know many examples of liquids. But if you think about a zero temperature phase, a quantum phase, it turns out there are many more constraints. So, for example, if you ask, can I get a liquid of bosons, right? So something that flows in some sort of liquid state of bosons, so let's say something that's interacting and flows, is there such a candidate? So we know, of course, one candidate, which is a superfluid, right? You can have bosons that condense into a superfluid. But it's very difficult to think of a state of bosons which is liquid, which is, you know, not just a crystal, but can also flow, and is not a superfluid, something that's intermediate.
What about just normal liquids? Or are you talking about your zero temperature?
That's right. So when you think about a quantum phase, right? You take any regular material, cool it to very low temperatures, you either get a solid, or in a few cases, you get a superfluid, right? Or a superconductor, something like that. So the constraints on a low temperature phase are much stronger than on, you know, classical or thermal phases. So the question was, suppose I take bosons of half filling on a square lattice, let's say, and you find a phase which is you know, translationally symmetric. Would you call that a Bose liquid? Okay, so that's a, so, you know, one thing that would happen is such a phase would have zero, you know, think of the bosons as being charged. Such a phase would be an electrical insulator, right? So if you think about liquid in the usual sense, it's something that can conduct you know, electricity. The simplest version is the ones where these, you have a gap to the first excited state of these bosons, that would be a version of an insulator. But there are somewhat more complicated phases that you can write down, and I think Matthew and Fisher will talk about these. That there's no such excitation gap. You get a ground state where the bosons are, you know, they form something that's homogeneous. It's not a crystal, but you have very low energy excitations. And in a way, these bosons might behave rather like fermions. So I asked the same question about fermions. We could easily get a liquid. We know there's a Fermi liquid at low temperatures. So you can start with some collection of bosons, and if they're very strongly interacting, it may happen that the excitations are really fermionic. The emergent excitations, the low energy excitations, are actually fermionic. So we know some models like that, in which case I think it's reasonable to call it a Bose liquid. When you have very low energy excitations of these bosons, but yet it's not a superfluid.
Is there some sort of mechanical definition of such a thing? Like, usually liquid, it's a liquid because, you know, if I... how do you call this?
Shift. Viscosity, yeah.
Right.
Sorry, it doesn't support a shift, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so is there such a definition for a quantum system?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so the, you know, the word liquid is being used in two different ways over here. So for example, when you say there's a quantum spin liquid, right, what does that mean? So, you know, many of these quantum spin liquids we'll talk about are not able to transport spin. They're not a liquid in the same sense that you think of liquid water as being able to, if you shear it, things move and so on. It's being thought of as a liquid in the sense that it's not ordered, so it's not like a crystal, but it's not like a gas either. It's not like these spins are disordered because they don't interact. They interact very strongly, but yet they don't order. Okay, so that's one sense in which the word liquid is being used. A different sense in which it's being used is really in terms of these sort of mechanical properties, conduction properties. So not every spin liquid in that definition is a liquid in sort of transport definition that we may have. So there's a further distinction of that. So there's some spin liquids which are gapless and you know, which are, you know, for example, the one we talked about before at the beginning of the talk, that would be a liquid in both the senses. The spin liquid in the sense the spins are not ordered, but it's sort of like a fermionic system in its many of its properties. It looks like a metal in many of its properties. So that would be a really good example of a state which has liquid properties in both transport and in fact that it's not ordered.
I think the simplest example that we know of is glass, right? To the extent that, you know, some would believe that glass is a distinct state of matter, so that would be an example. It's, I mean, statistically, it's translationally invariant and isotropic, but you know, if you, then it's localized, you can't move, you can't transport that shape.
Although, and again, this and things are frozen in the glass, where there's no, things are not fluctuating around the very low temperatures. Whereas in a quantum spin liquid, the spins are strongly fluctuating around low temperatures. And it's really the quantum mechanics that gives you the disorder. Okay, any more questions? Okay, so the last few minutes, let me tell you about one very interesting connection that you know, could have saved you a lot of work, you know, at least conceptually could have saved a lot of work in terms of trying to identify which phases could have arisen in such a triangular lattice model. So what I'll do, what I'll talk about is how to connect this, the Dymer model, the Dymer representation that we had, to a lattice gauge theory. To gauge theories. And so a lot is known about gauge theory, so there's a big literature out there. And if you can make such connections, it's extremely useful. Okay, so you can sort of take over things that are known from that topic and immediately get some results. Okay, so this again is sort of a paradigm for many other problems where in frustrated magnetism. So the essential, you know, conceptual link between frustrated magnetism and gauge theories, at least one link. So we said before that in frustrated magnets, you have this space of degenerate ground states. Okay, so there are many states that are ground states, but not every state, of course, is a ground state. Right? There's some constraint. So the space of ground states is a constrained space. Now, gauge theories are also, you can view them as theories which have a constraint. Right? So the most best known example of a gauge theory is just Maxwell electrodynamics. So let's say I have electrodynamics, and let me just focus on the gauge part of it. So say I have no electrical charges. Then your electric and magnetic fields satisfy a constraint. Right? The divergence of the electric field is zero, the divergence of the magnetic field is zero. So you're really working with a system, a set of fields, where the initial conditions that you describe have to satisfy this constraint. So again, you're working with a set of configurations that are constrained. So it may be, you know, conceptually there's this link. So in some cases, we can actually make this precise. We can actually show that the constraint you want for the gauge theory is precisely the constraint that you have in a gauge theory. Not always, but often that can be done. Okay, so let's phrase this Dymer model as a model which has a constraint. Right? So I said before, the ground states of this Nysink model on the triangular lattice can be represented by this hardcore Dymer pattern. Go to the dual lattice on every bond, coming out of every side, there's one and only one bond which has a Dymer. Okay, that's this red over here. So let me think about a quantity that's defined on the bond, which tells me the Dymer density. So M is a quantity that depends, that lives on the bond. A bond is specified by two sides, I and J. So Nij is this bond over here. If N is zero, there's no Dymer. If N is one, there's Dymer. Okay, so this, the different configurations that we have are all represented by Dymer densities that satisfy this constraint. If I sum around a particular site, all of the bonds around a particular site, there's one of them that has the Dymer, so it sums to one. Okay, so why does this look like electromagnetism? Okay, so one very important input over here is that this honeycomb lattice is a bipartite lattice, right? So I can label sites on this honeycomb lattice with the letters A and B. So this is A, B, A, B, and so on. And these bonds only connect sites A to sites B. And so it's a bipartite lattice. So on such a bipartite lattice, it turns out I can convert this Dymer model or this Dymer representation into something that looks like electromagnetism. Okay, so because I have this bipartite representation, on every bond I can draw an arrow. The arrow, there's a natural way of drawing these arrows. So you can say that out of site A, there's an arrow that goes to site B. Okay, so at site B, all the arrows point in, not site A, all the arrows point out. Okay, so now what I can do is I can convert this Dymer density into a vector field. If I have a Dymer that's occupying this particular bond, I'll say that there's a vector that points from this side to that side. Okay, so I'll define this, this is a formal way of saying it. There's some Eij, a vector field, that's either plus or minus of this Dymer density, depending on whether the first side belongs to the A or belongs to the B sometimes. Okay, so I've essentially been able to convert the configurations of this model into some vector field.
What about the other two Maxwell equations?
Yeah.
So scalar potential will provide all these constraints, and in this sense, it's analogous to electrodynamics, right? I would say if I look at the equation of motion for my vector potential or scalar potential actually doesn't have conjugate momentum, so it's a constraint, and the vector potential will give a dynamic equation. So you say constraints are similar, but what about the dynamics part?
Yeah, so it turns out the dynamics is the most natural dynamics that's consistent with that constraint. Right, so the dynamics of the electromagnetic field is such that if you start with some configuration that satisfies the constraint, it stays that way in time.
Right.
And you know, one way of thinking about it is write down the simplest equations that you can, which preserve that constraint. Those are the Maxwell equations. So if you end up in this constraint space, and you have a generic system, right, something which has the most natural dynamics, you're more or less guaranteed to get the right dynamics. That's right, yeah. It's sort of the lowest order dynamics you can write down. Okay, but, you know, so we can go into a little more detail. Let's see if we have time. So the simplest model that you can write down on this honeycomb lab, as it turns out, it has that, the usual Maxwell dynamics. If you think about it in terms of Hamiltonians, it's some low order expansion of the Hamiltonian in terms of the electromagnetic fields. So you get that dynamics. You may have corrections to that, but at long time scales and log, length scales, that's usually the only dynamics that's consistent.
So now I think, I know there are, magnets with k-squared dispersion.
But they are protected by symmetry.
Right.
So that's only in an SU2 ferromagnet they get magnets with k-squared dispersion. It's a very special case. So as long as you don't have some special reason like that, you'll get the regular dynamics.
Okay, so
this constraint over here turns out to be a constraint on these vector fields, which tell you that the sum of these vector fields coming out of a site is either plus one or minus one, depending on which of these two sublattices you look at. Okay, so this constraint over here, you can really think of it as a lattice version of a divergence of the electric field operator. Right, so if I just look at all the vectors coming out of the site, and I'm summing these three vectors, it's like I'm taking the divergence of this electric field. Okay, so what this constraint is, if I were to think about it in the continuum, is that the divergence of this vector field is either plus one or minus one. It's some fixed quantity, depending on which site I'm looking at. Okay, so this is really like a Gauss law. And so this constraint on this electric field, the natural constraint on the electric field, the Gauss law, is the same as this Dammer constraint. Find that you have only one Dammer coming out of the site for these bipartite lattices. Okay, so this is really quantum. This is really suggesting that this is connected to quantum electrodynamics in the lattice. Okay, and it's what one might call a U1 gauge theory. That's just a way of, that's just in jargon for this regular Maxwell electrodynamics. Okay, so when you have a gauge theory, there are two possible phases. There's one phase that's very natural that we all know about, where you have photons, right? You have regular Maxwell equations taking over, you have photons. This is something called the Coulomb phase, right? So you have Coulomb interaction between charges if they were present. It turned out that actually corresponds via this mapping to Dammers and eventually to the spin system to a liquid state. In that phase, these electric fields are all fluctuating around, and the electric fields, if you recall, tell us really the pattern of the spins, and what's going on with the spins. Yeah.
How do you define the photon in terms of the U1 gauge field on this honeycomb lattice?
So the mapping that we just showed, and I just showed you, that allows you to define something like an electric field. So that's kind of half the story, right? And you need also the magnetic field. So you can ask, what is the analog of the magnetic field in this particular case? So if you have a quantum system, so the electric field is taking on some numbers 0 and 1 on these 0 plus minus 1 on these bonds. There's a conjugate variable that will change, that will commute, it will have a commutation relation with this electric field. Let me just call it A for the moment. Okay, so just like there's, you know, position and momentum, there's some conjugate variable. Okay, so it's actually easy to argue that this conjugate variable is really the vector potential. Okay, so if you recall, one way of writing the electric field is as the time derivative of the vector potential. Okay, so it's a bit like the velocity of the vector potential, or roughly speaking, the momentum corresponding conjugate to the vector potential. Okay, so the electric field and the vector potential are conjugate variables. So the thing that induces quantum fluctuations in the electric field is some analog of this vector potential. Okay, so there's also another field, the vector potential, that gives you fluctuations of this. And that's there in the theory, because we know that once we include quantum fluctuations, the Dama patterns can change around. Okay, there is some dynamics. So you can try and write down some Hamiltonian, the most general Hamiltonian for this thing. There's some energy cost for making large electric fields. And then there's something like a magnetic field squared term. Right, so the magnetic field is like curl of this vector potential. Okay, so if this Hamiltonian over here, if you look at its excitation, so I've really sort of ignored the lattice in this description. I've gone from the lattice to the continuum. So in the cases when you can do that, this continuum description tells you that you will have photons in your theory. So it looks like a harmonic oscillator theory. There's a momentum squared and there's a position squared. But the position squared comes with a, wave vector attached to it. So it has oscillations which are photons. The real question is, can you go from this lattice theory to this continuum theory? Is there some, is it rigorous to, is it mathematically justified to ignore the fact that you live on a lattice, that your electric fields can only take on value 0 plus minus 1? Or can you just go to this very general description where the electric field is some real number and it lives in continuum? Okay, so that is the key question. Can you do that? Can you make that leap? So if you can't, the more natural field that you can get on the lattice is when these electric fields just take on some fixed values. Okay, they don't fluctuate much. They're kind of frozen. And that really corresponds to magnetic order. Right? If I give you, tell you exactly where the dimers are, it will specify the magnetic order for you. That's a magnetically ordered state. Okay, whereas this other phase where these electric fields are fluctuating around is really a liquid state of the space. Okay, so now it turns out, you can ask which of these two phases are realized, and can we draw a phase diagram? Is there some critical coupling beyond which I go from this electric field frozen to this other phase? Okay, so you might think that as I increase the quantum fluctuations, I get more and more of this term. You get stronger quantum fluctuations of the electric field. Eventually, you go into this, you might go into this phase where everything is fluctuating around. Okay, so there's an amazing result due to Polyakov from this, from the field theory side, which is which gives us some general information about this gauge theory. It says that in two dimensions, it's never okay to make this jump. Never okay to make the jump from the lattice to this theory in terms of this continuum theory, which has photons. Okay, in a real system, it will always happen. It will always turn out that the system has only one phase. You're always forced to be in this confined phase. Okay, and maybe next time I can give you some intuition why this happens. But you know, normally when you think about a model and drawing the phase diagram of the model, you'd like to know what parameters you have to describe which phase you're in. Okay, so the amazing thing about this result is that it's sort of Hamiltonian independent. Once you tell me that you've mapped your problem with this U1 gauge theory, there's only one phase. And that phase turns out to be the phase which corresponds to magnetic order. Okay, so the ingredients that went into this was, the very important ingredient that went in, is that we can describe our states in terms of dimers on this bipartite lattice. Okay, the bipartiteness was very important. So if you want to beat this and go into a spin liquid phase, you have to relax one of these conditions. Okay, so one of the things you might want to do is to think about models where you don't have bipartite lattices. Okay, or there are other ways in which you can change the gauge group. We said this was a U1 gauge theory. You have to change the gauge group in some way. One way is to go to a non-bipartite lattice, something other than the honeycomb, for example. Another thing you can do is to go to one higher dimension. So this theorem of Polyakov only works in two dimensions. If you went to three dimensions, it turns out you could get this liquid phase, you could get the Coulomb phase, And we'll see how that's related to the spin ice materials we talked about before. Okay, and finally, the third way in which you can escape is that all of this was for a pure gauge theory, where there were no electrical charges at all. If you have some other fields which carry electrical charge, then there are ways of getting phases that are not confined. And some of the most interesting proposals right now for these spin liquids, these critical spin liquids, are of that variety. Also, we can get new kinds of quantum phase transitions in that way. So some of these, hopefully, we'll be able to discuss tomorrow. Okay, but let me leave you with these references if you want to learn more about lattice gauge theories. Very nice review by Pogut. It also tells you, many tricks how to go from partition functions to Hamiltonian representations and things like that if you're not familiar. And it gives you an introduction to these simple lattice gauge theories. And if you want to see the same thing from a more condensed matter viewpoint, there's a review by Sachdev. These are the relevant pages. He has a different approach to map spin models to gauge theories. So what we described was one approach for a particular class, but it turns out there are many different starting points you can take and ultimately end up with gauge theory descriptions of these spin models. And that has another approach. But let me end there.
So if you broke time reversal symmetry, you could have a transient term for the gauge field.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. That's another way to be.
So then could you get something interesting in these models if you, say, found a small external magnetic field, but still had some highly frustrated system?
Yeah, that's a good question. I've not thought about it. So for example, you're saying this gamma model and kind of this honeycomb lattice. Yeah, I think the question there might be, how do you generate a Chern-Simons term in that language? So magnetic field of, but for what, right? I mean, maybe you might want to have in this quantum dynamics term, you might want to have some other phase attached to it, rather than just plus minus one. Maybe you can generalize it that way. It's an interesting question.
So at least in Polyakov's story, you know, you could make this confinement length long if you choose some coupling. So can you imagine some coupling in the lattice model that so you have some really large intermediate scale where it actually is photons, even though ultimately it's not.
That's right, yeah. So if you give me another parameter to tune, if you give me a few parameters, you can actually tune to a point where it's deconfined. Right, so that's certainly possible. You can have points in the phase diagram where you actually have a liquid-like state. But if you pick a generic model, you expect it to be somewhere bang in the middle of a phase. Maybe not, but typically that's what you expect. In which case, you would expect it to have order one confinement scale. But yeah, there are ways. In fact, the simplest wave function you can write down for this Dammer model, take a wave function with equal superposition of all of the different Dammer states. So it turns out that thing is not confined. It happens miraculously to be at this very special point where you don't get confined. That's the Slavshak-Kabelson point. But that's not a generic state. There's no generic Hamiltonian which will give you that as the ground state. Generic Hamiltonian put you deep inside the confined fields. Questions.